Hey y'all, welcome to part 8 of the Vectric version 12 plus for absolute beginner series. In this video, we're going to get into one of the lesser used toolpaths, and that is the drilling toolpath. Now, even though I'm demonstrating this in VCarve Pro version 12.010, this works exactly the same way in Cut 2D Desktop and Pro, VCarve Desktop and Pro, and Aspire. Now, I have gone ahead and drawn a few circles here just to use to demonstrate this toolpath. Using the toolpath itself is very simple, but there are a few things you need to keep in mind. You'll notice that the circles I have drawn out here are two different sizes. These three circles are 1/4 inch diameter. This circle is 1/8 inch diameter. And I did it this way to demonstrate the fact that on the CAD side of the drilling toolpath, the size of the circle does not determine the size of the hole that's going to be drilled. The diameter of the hole that's going to be drilled is 100% dependent on the size of the tool you use to drill it. We have to remember that the way the drilling toolpath works is, it's designed to do one thing and one thing only, and that is to plunge straight down into the material and retract straight up out of the material. With that in mind, one of the crucial things to remember is, when using the drilling toolpath, do not use a downcut bit. Doesn't matter if it's an end mill, a ball nose, whatever. Never attempt to use a downcut bit with the drilling toolpath. The potential for starting a fire is too great. And I know this from personal experience. When I was just getting started in CNC, I attempted to drill a series of holes using a downcut spiral end mill, and I started a fire on my CNC machine. This is not a story I heard from somebody else. This happened to me personally. I started a fire. Do not drill with a downcut bit of any kind, period. With that warning out of the way, let's go ahead and get into the toolpath. We'll click on our toolpath icon, and as you can see, it's a pretty short form, and there aren't that many options, because again, it's designed to plunge straight down and retract straight out. We'll go ahead and select all of our vectors, and we'll start from the top of the form. Start depth is going to be 0. Because there's nothing else out here on our material, we're going to start at the surface of the material. We're going to do a depth of 1/2 inch. That's going to drill straight down, then retract straight out. One of the few options that we do have is something called Peck Drilling. Now, if I don't use Peck Drilling, what's going to happen is the bit's going to move over to the position of the first hole, plunge straight down 1/2 inch deep, and then retract straight out, then move to the next hole. Repeat the process, move to the next hole, repeat the process, etc. Peck drilling is where the bit will plunge to a certain point, retract, then plunge again, then retract, then plunge again, then retract. There are a few other options within this option, but we'll get into those in just a second. Peck drilling is normally used with metals and denser materials. For instance, it is used in really dense hardwoods like hard maple, purple heart, things of that nature. Any kind of dense material where there's a possibility of creating a lot of heat with doing a drilling operation. Remember, The reason for using an upcut bit is to eject the chips out of this hole as quickly as possible, taking all that heat with it. So peck drilling is used to make life easier for the bit to accomplish what we want, but generally speaking, with softer materials, it's not needed. I do not use peck drilling when drilling into plastics such as HDPE or acrylic or foam. In softer hardwoods, I don't use peck drilling, but if I get to the level of white oak, maple, purple heart, I do use peck drilling. Now, within peck drilling, we have a couple of options. We can have it retract above the cutting start depth. What that means is the drill is going to plunge straight down to the peck depth, then retract all the way up to the starting depth, which in this case is zero. So it'll come all the way up to the surface of the material, then plunge down to the next peck depth, then retract to the surface of the material, and proceed until it gets to the cutting depth. Or you can have it retract above the height of the previous pass. Now, the peck depth on this particular toolpath is set right now to 1/8 of an inch. So to go to a half an inch, it's going to plunge down that first 1/8 of an inch, lift up to zero, plunge down to the next 1/8 of an inch, then retract back up to zero, plunge down to the next 1/8 of an inch, then return back up to zero. Or you can have it just retract above the height of the previous pass, meaning the first plunge will come down to the first peck depth and retract up to zero. The next plunge will take it down to the next peck depth, then it will retract up to the level of the first peck, then plunge down again, then retract to the level of the last peck. This is totally up to you. Personally, I prefer to retract above the cutting start depth. Again, you want to clear those chips out of the hole as quickly as possible. This also gives the bit a couple of extra seconds to cool down before the next plunge. And again, this is especially the case in denser materials. Now we have a note here to read, and that is the peck depth is controlled by the pass depth of the tool. Now you'll notice my peck depth is 1/8 of an inch. If I come back up here for this 1/4 inch end mill, I click on edit, I can see that that's what the pass depth is set at. If I'm carving into a lighter weight material, I probably won't use peck drilling. But if I wanted to change the peck depth, all I have to do is change the pass depth, click OK, and we see my peck depth is now 1/4 of an inch. And again, the peck depth is what determines how many times this bit plunges down into the material until it reaches the cut depth desired. So, again, if I'm using softer materials like foam, for instance, I won't use peck drilling. I'll let it plunge all the way to the cutting depth, then retract, getting those chips out of there as quickly as possible. Now, the next option we have is dwell at the bottom of each drill pass. Dwell is basically a pause. What this option will do is, for instance, in this situation where I have a peck depth of 1/4 of an inch, if I set a dwell at the bottom of each drill pass, the bit's going to plunge down that first 1/4 of an inch, then stay there for however many seconds I set in the dwell time. Then it will retract. If you are drilling anything but metal, your best bet is not to use this. Again, you want to evacuate those chips and get that bit out of the material as quickly as possible to reduce the amount of heat buildup you get on your tool. If you are cutting metals, there are situations where you would want this to happen. But when you're cutting hardwoods, foam, acrylic, plastics, you want that bit and those chips out of there as quickly as you can get them. Do not dwell at the bottom of the drill pass. The only other options here so far are use the vector selection order. We'll get into that in another video. That's outside of the scope of this video. Project tool path onto a 3D model, meaning you can drill into the surface of a 3D model, such as a cribbage board or any other 3D model. Vector selection, again, this is outside of the scope of this video. So all we have left is the name of our tool path. I'm going to go ahead and leave it drill 2, and we'll calculate the tool path. And if we zoom in on our tool path here, we can see that we have these red lines, which are rapid moves. In this tool path that we just calculated, the bit's going to move from the XY datum position over to the first hole. It's going to plunge straight down, lift straight out, move to the next hole, and repeat all the way across. Now again, looking at the 2D view, I have 4 different sizes of vector, but you see what the toolpath is going to do. The toolpath is disregarding the size of this vector, but it's going to drill based on the center of this vector. So again, in the CAM side of the software, the vector does not determine the size of the hole. It determines the location of the hole to be drilled. The only thing that determines the size of the hole to be drilled is the tool being used to drill it. So we can go ahead and preview this, and it just looks like 4 holes to be drilled. The thing to remember about the drilling toolpath is bit selection is the most important factor. Again, do not ever use a downcut bit with the drilling toolpath. So I hope you got something out of this video. And if you did, I do hope you'll give it a thumbs up. Now, I know I probably didn't answer all of your questions about the drilling toolpath. So, this afternoon at noon Pacific, 3 p.m. Eastern, I'll be hosting a live Q&A session where you can ask me any questions you may have about anything I've presented in this video or any of my previous videos. Again, that's today at noon Pacific, 3 p.m. Eastern, right here on my YouTube channel. And I put a link to that live Q&A session down in the description box of this video. Now, before we wrap this up, I'd like to give a special shout out and say a special thank you to all of my channel members. Thank you, channel members. I appreciate your continued support. If you would like information on how to become a channel member, just click that little join button down beneath this video panel. Another panel will pop up, and a video will play that'll tell you all about channel membership. So, I hope to see you all this afternoon for a live Q&A session. And as always, whether you subscribe to my channel or not, whether you become a channel member or not, I'd like to thank you very much for taking the time to watch, and y'all take care.